So the idea here is, right, we all, this is DPDK focused, but containers and then edge are the buzzwords right now, right? So many, many efforts are happening. So the idea here is to see, you know, DPDK coming from this side, performance, right, getting everything, the last juice from a platform. And then here is your container, more scalability, ease of deployment, elasticity, where, yeah, performance is possibly second order, right? Whereas here, the scalability and elasticity and then portability, packaging, those things may be second order, but how they are going to be now meeting and where, what's happening in the industry, right? That is the talk. And now, you may be already seen in a roadmap in dpdk.org, you might have seen that we talk about huge page as a must, right? We talk about core pinning as a must. But then when you talk about cloud, it says like, well, I want agnostic hardware and movabilities. So those are conflicting, right? So DPDK is already talking about not necessarily only huge page being the option. You may be all knowing that. And also, you need to allocate everything upfront, not something you have the luxury to ask for resources during the runtime from the budgeting point of view. But now cloud says, well, no, you cannot allocate everything. No, you cannot be greedy. So we now are moving DPDK into the space where 4K pages, as you saw Hemant talking about, you know, releasing, allocating, all possibilities. That is taking DPDK into container world. But container is also doing similar thing, right? That's also coming towards DPDK. That's what we are going to talk about today, some of the plugins, what DPDK, what container is going to have the best of both worlds. Right, the performance and everything in addition to, so best of the both in terms of both container as well as DPDK. So how many of you have worked in this type of plugins, DPDK plugins with container already? Anybody? Any? Okay. How many of you have worked on the other side, like, you know, DPDK's movement towards container or DPDK's container's movement towards DPDK? You have worked on that? Can you share some of the challenges or some of the... Okay. Performance is okay. Oh, thank you so much. Okay, great. So that is the one, okay. So I have been working with the DPDK from 2009 or 2008 time frame, but then for as far as Kubernetes started only working very recently. So my idea is to here to learn more from you all on the container part, okay? So we are going to talk about four features which are DPDK plugins, okay? So we are going to talk about four features. One is called node discovery. Why it is needed? Because when you're talking about enhanced platform awareness, right? We're talking about networking, we're talking about SRIO, these are the things which we talk in DPDK. But in a system, in a container cluster, how do I know whether this one has SRIOV, capable, high performance network card, right? How do I know? So those are things that are done by network discovery. And then once I know, how do I'm going to take the benefit out of that by pinning, and that's where we are going to talk about something called CPU core manager. There's something called CNI, right? Container network interface. If you see today, you have pretty much container with only one network interface, and that's for only connecting the containers among the containers, right? Whereas we are talking about data plane, high performance type of thing, right? So that is another one called CNI plugins, and there you will have family of CNI plugins. So we are going to look at all those things. And then we will connect all of that together by having multiple block diagrams here. Okay, so we'll talk about container versus VM, and what do you really want? We talked about two spectrums, right? One is scalability, flexibility, packaging, and then other side is performance. Normally we start with something and then customer like it, and then down the road they have asked the other one, right? That's what happens all the time, right? So then we meet in between. So here is your container, this thing, hypervisor based, and that's your container based. And so you don't have to have that much overhead. I think it is now, timer is not set properly. I think it is moving by itself now, anyway. So if you see here, so you have pods, and in these pods you can have multiple containers, and a node can have multiple pods. Now, what is the commonality here? Let's say you have multiple containers, they are all sharing some same namespace, sharing resources, then you may want to be clubbing all those containers in one single pod, right? And that's how the sharing happens. And then if they are not, their namespace is different, then you put them in a different pod, but then you can have one node with multiple pods and multiple containers in your pod. Now, you have a master core, master node, as well as a master container, and they call it a minion container. Minion containers are more like a worker containers, and master container is more like a controller container. And if you want a HA, right, high availability, then in a particular node, you will have multiple master containers. So that's the big topology you're talking about. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to compare, so many of us are, at least myself, right, I'm more into DPDK. So for me, this verse did not mean much, right? All these things really scared me, so kubelet and all these things, right? So what I wanted to understand is, hey, everything is basically a similar system, so how can I map this terminologies to what I know already in DPDK? In DPDK, I know EAL. Is there anything, something similar to that in Kubernetes? Thereby, when I look that word, I can map to my previous experience. So I will have next two files which will map the terminologies of DPDK with terminologies of Kubernetes, but the commonality is pretty much similar. Again, it's not exactly equal, but similar functionality. Thereby, many of you who are experts knows everything in DPDK, but never had time to ramp up on containers, I think those two files will be able to, okay, that's what that is. Then when you go and look at white paper, you can like, you know, boom, 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 right? Like that's the idea of putting that. Because I was not understanding what is scheduler, what is etc storage, controller manager, API server, everything seems to be new words, right? Okay, and so this is the overview. This is more like Wikipedia, you know, copy and paste. So I'm not going to take a lot of time on that, but I'm going to stop talking and let you see and absorb maybe for 30 seconds. Right? So container is the one which we right talking about the packaging and the abstraction at application level, right? Kubernetes is more like a automation for deployment and management. And the pod is what we talked about, right? The minimum unit of deployment. And the node is one which is like, you know, you can have multiple pods in one node, but then the control is at a node level. And then we talked about master and minion, which is master is the controlling and configuration aspect, and then minions are the real workers, right? So I will say master is like a manager, and minions are like engineers like you and me, right? Doing the real work. Okay. I don't think my manager is here. Anyway, good. He's there? Okay. So this fits it all together, okay? So if you look at it, you may have a lot of minions, right? If you're in a big corporation, you know, right? There's one manager, you have a lot of people. And another manager coming and asking, hey, I want that guy to solve my problem for 1 week. This manager will not like that another guy knowing that particular person by name. He will want, you tell me what work is needed, I will give resource, right? That's how they use. And we don't like the word resource when they say, right? But anyway, same way here, you cannot, the container gives similar abstraction. The API server is that manager who's sitting there telling, you tell me what you want, I will give. So thereby, you cannot really go and ask the minion whom you want. The API server will do that interface, right? And this is where all the batches and labels and all those things are stored, etc. And then the scheduler is the one who schedules into the real minions which work has to be done and what has to be done type of thing. Any questions till now? Is these things looks the words looks very easy to you? Are you familiar already with these things? I was not familiar when I started looking at that. So let us go into those comparison. Macrocosm and microcosm, commonality. So before we get into this, right, can you give an example of macrocosm and microcosm comparison commonality? So, you know, many of you might not have born when I started working, right? So I'm very old. That's why I'm going back to these type of words, macrocosm and microcosm. So if you talk about this whole universe, you can consider that as a macrocosm, right? And you can't talk about an individual person, you can talk about it as a microcosm. The commonality is they say, like, even if you say Earth, right, 75% is water and 25% is the Earth, same thing for us too, right? That's a commonality in a way. And similarly, they talk about what? Five things? Fire, water. What are the five natural things? Fire, water, air, earth, and then sky, right? And if you map, that's a macrocosm. If you map that into microcosm, so the earth is what we eat, right? Today we ate the food, right? That's the earth coming from the earth. The water we drink, the air we breathe. What are the other two? Fire, what is the fire? The work we do. Right? The minions do a lot of this thing, fire, right? Work we do. That's why we burn the energy by doing the work. So that's the fire. What's the last one? Akash, sky, right? What is that? How do you map that? Sleep. They were sleeping, right? That sleep reduces the space between, increases or reduces the space between the blood vessels, the cells, it seems. That's why people don't sleep, work hard continuously, get blood pressure or whatever, whereas if you sleep enough, you feel relaxed, right? I'm going to pattern the last one. That's my idea. So if you look at that, similarly, if you see container, all these words, what we talked about as a macrocosm, and let us use our DPDK known knowledge as a microcosm, how do we map? That's the next file. So here, when they say master container, that is exactly same as your DPDK control plane master core 0. Master core 0, what it does? It doesn't really do that packet processing data plane. It is setting up, it is launching the thread in all the other cores, right? If you go and look at the EIL, it launches it all the thing. So similarly, you have your, oh my God. Okay, this is similar to that control plane master core, that's what master container. And then pod, when you say pod, that is the minimum unit where you can schedule something. So if you can look at DPDK, we talk about L core, right? Logical core. The thread, hyper thread or logical core, that is that one. And when you say one node can have multiple pod, we talked about that, right? And if you see that comparison, the node is similar to your physical load. Because when you have hyper threading, you have hyper threading enabled, you have two L cores in one physical core. And they all use common resource, right? L1, L2, L3, pretty much all of them are common. Similar mapping in case you are using pod and node concept. The way I would, again, as I said, right, it's all similar functionality. We cannot completely make it equal, right? So the way you can visualize is one node can have multiple pods, and in one pod, you can put many containers which are all having common shareable resources, same namespace. Then you put them in one pod.
Because the number of L core is also mentioned in a node,
right?
It's limited.
Correct.
But the pod can be 1,000.
Correct. So that's what I'm saying. Again, we are not going to be completely saying every aspect is equal, right? I'm just giving functionality wise for us to remember, right? And microservice is more like your pthread or lthread, and then we said minion is our worker core. And API server, right? This is what I was talking about, the manager who sits in between, not giving visibility into the individual abstracts away, and individual minions are not exposed outside. Same as a load balancer. Load balancer takes care of 20 minutes already. Load balancer already. So give me some indication it is 10 minutes more, okay? So where are we? Okay. So similar to that, the DPDK load balancer is the one which abstracts and then uses the five tuple and then sends the work to the worker thread. Similarly, the API server takes care of that. Okay. And scheduler functionality is same as, you know, CPU pinning, hyper thread sharing L1, L2, non-sibling sharing L3 cache, and similar to that. And the controller manager is the one which is a resources management. So in DPDK, we have EIL to do the resource management. Similar concept is done in the controller manager. And we talked about etcd. That is the where you have all the mapping of and label and tagging of the nodes, what property it has, and then when you have a request, depending upon the resource capability available, which one you want to do the work. Those type of database is there in the etc. And then kubelet is the dispatcher. So if you see DPDK, we also have a dispatcher. We don't talk about it much, but if you talk about the frameworks, we do have a dispatcher, and that's the concept that you have kubelet. Okay. So putting all this together, I think we started with that, and we just now went through the names, and then we said, you know, what is master equivalent, and then what is etc equivalent, and then scheduler. We just saw that in our known DPDK terminologies. Now let us drill down, right? So what are the gaps that a container today has? Since it was designed for more elasticity, some of these performance optimizations are not the primary thing. So that's where the EPA comes in, and as we said, for you have to do the node feature discovery. What do we mean by node feature discovery? CPU ID, let's say I want to run these things on only on Skylake, and I know Skylake's CPU ID. So through node feature discovery, it's like a one-time shot. It is not something dynamically you go and change. It's a one-time start. To start with, it will go and find out which CPU ID is in this particular cluster, and it will all register in that etc database, and that's what it will use later for mapping the tasks into that desired cores, desired features. And so we talk about this grub, right? In DPDK, we have grub where you put isol CPU, no copy back. How many of you know what I'm talking about? If you just run DPDK as it is, your Linux scheduler will come and screw it up. Whereas if you go and put in the grub, hey, Linux scheduler, go away, go away. I just don't want you to touch this. So that is what similar to that, what we're talking about in CPU manager plugin for Kubernetes. So these were not by default there in containers, and we are introducing these things, right? Because of the DPDK's effort. And similarly, SRIOV. SRIOV, when you say your DPDK SRIOV, you have a kernel SRIOV. Both needs to be supported, and both are supported through these plugins. Okay, so all these things together, right? Look at this. So these are the database I was talking about. The tag, okay, so node 1 has Skylake, it has a resource director. How many of you are familiar with the word resource director? Noisy neighbor, have you heard the word noisy neighbor? Cache allocation technology, cache monitoring technology. So those features are there in node 1, that is not there in node 2. The node 2 has only the, say, Skylake or whatever, right, something like that. So those information is stored in that, but how do you know that? On power on, there is something called a discovery pod. So any node that has no label, that is no characterization done yet, the discovery pod will be run, and that will go and peek and find out what's the capabilities, and then it will report it, and then the master will store it in. This guy, Ramesh, he works Saturday, Sunday, any day, weekend, weeknight, I can call him for work. So he tags those type of work, right, tagging that minions nature. And pretty much that's what it is, and that is the discovery part, and this is a regular part, and then these are runtime environments, and that's how the node selection is done, okay. I'm also giving here and there some of the links. If you want to take a picture of that, GitHubs and links, feel free to do that. Okay, putting all these things together in a big picture, right? So if you see, this is a master, and then this is a minion. How do I say that? Why that is not a minion? Why this is a master? What makes the difference? The API server is here, right? Yeah, master only will have the API server, right? Don't talk to my guys. I know, right? That's here. And the manager is here, whereas here are only two things, kubelet and kubeproxy. Kubelet is the one who starts first, and then communicates and registers to the manager, right? It's like a timesheet, right? I'm here, give me work type of thing. Now, by default, containers have only one network interface. They don't have multiple network interface, right? But why do we need multiple network interface? Possibly, now we are talking about user space, so you may want to have different stacks, and you want to map to different ports. And possibly you have the same stack, but different configurations for various parameters, right? Those flexibility comes with multiple network. Also, you want to have your control, your management, your application, your data plane, everything segregated. So those things are needed, and that's where these things comes in, CNI, right? CNI, and there you can have the regular default gateway type of connectivity. We have this flannel is the, and then again Calico flannel, many of those things are here. And then you have SRIOV plugin. It can be, and then yesterday we had a session where we talked about AF interface, we had talked about VHOS, so those things can also be there. So, so the node discovery we talked about, and the CNI plugin interface we talked about takes care of those initialization. Okay, and here is your network function discovery component, and here is your CPU core managers for Kubernetes. Yeah, the actual data plane for high performance, you will be using only this part. The regular the overlay and your control, the network connectivity and default gateway, you will use the by default what comes with the Kubernetes, right? Now there is also, okay, yeah, that's where. And then when you install a virtual box or you know, VM player, you also have a default bridge that comes with it, right? Similarly, you have a concept of Docker bridge or what they call it, KubeNet. So if you see the if you layer, KubeNet may be the first one, and then CNI, and then you can think about your SRIOV. But then KubeNet is pretty much getting depreciated. They are putting all those bells and whistles of KubeNet into now CNI. So you can think of CNI to be the first one getting started, and then CNI calling one by one, lexicographical way, all the other interfaces, what you say. Any, but the use case we are talking about is taking a VNF and then containerizing. Right, when you do containerize it, that's what you're talking about. Okay, so that's what we talked about, Docker Zero. Default networking of Docker. That is exactly what we're talking about, similar to your VM player or virtual box that comes with that simple. And then the next one is the CNI. This is what is the main key thing, which is very much layered and very much pluggable type of thing. And that's where you will have. So we talked about the reasons why you need multiple interface, right? Control plane, data plane segregation, multiple stacks, network slicing. Slicing offers direct access to high performance NIC hardware. But to know where the high performance NIC hardware is available, you need to go into the node discovery and other things, right? I mean, are we going very fast or is it fine? Okay. So CNI plugins, right? Just quickly what it is it's an executable that is invoked by a container management system, the runtime one, and then it is the one which is responsible for adding additional network interfaces. And even there, you want to have which one is the master in that, which one is, can be in the minions, right? Because you want the default gateway and other things to go through that, DNS and the DHCP, you want to go through the master one, and that will be the first one that gets instantiated, and then the other ones will be later. So the summary is, the container's runtime must create a new network namespace for the container before invoking any plugins. The runtime must then determine which networks this container should belong to, and for each network, which plugins must be executed. So this is where we talk about talking about whether SRIOV, DPDK SRIOV, or kernel SRIOV, or even a regular, tuntop type of Linux interface. So this is the workflow. The kubelet is the one which is, talks to the master and registers in every minion node. That starts first, and if it is properly programmed or properly configured, it knows where and which directory the CNI is available. So it will give the control to that, and that will now have a configuration file structure which will go through each one, lexical order, and then it will take first one as the master plugin, and then further ones it will give control. And they will now, in each module by itself will then instantiate by knowing the, you may be having a VF, you may be having a AVF, and that's what it will create, right? This is from top to bottom. Now there's also another layer from bottom to top where the SRIOV device finding, because you may have multiple VF, but you want to also configure each one of them differently. So that's where that comes. So both work together to get the job done. So if you put all these things together, right, you have the by default you have only one is zero, right? But then because of this multics, you are able to add additional ones, and then how that is done is what we saw at the flow, and here is more like a pictorial form, kubelet instantiate CNI and CNI calls multus, and multus goes back to the node label and it finds out, they talk about annotation in the node label for knowing the property of this node, and in that you will say I have this many network interfaces, and so then it will go one by one and it will instantiate and then give control to that and then program the IP address, program the routing table and all the other things, right? So if you see that picture, that's what it comes here. You have a DPDK, it's a non-SRIOV, this is SRIOV, and then your regular Linux bridge, which is the control plane type of thing. Okay, so this, we may want to take a picture of this because this is all the GitHub for each one component. We talked about CPU manager, just GitHub for that, right? So this file and the next file is worth taking picture. Okay, I will pause for maybe 10 seconds. And the next page will have similar ones. Okay, the next one. Container networking and then multus CNI, SRIOV network device plugin, SRIOV and then SRIOV network device plugin, SRIOV CNI. Do you see that? This is more like the SRIOV CNI is more like top to bottom for SRIOV, and then the SRIOV network device plugin is coming from bottom to top for SRIOV. Both has to work together. And then user space CNI. And then examples, there are examples. I think this is not really HTTPS GitHub. There is something, once you take that first one, then you will be able to find this directory in that. Okay. So we talked about CNI pretty much, right? We talked about CNI, we talked about how all those things fit together. We talked about the comparison between these two terminologies, DPDK and container. So now this one, I think we saw, but this one slightly shows more about what are all the capabilities that are there in node discovery. For example, whether you want your application to be put in a node with having these capabilities or these capabilities, right? That's what you will ask for, and this guy keeps that housekeeping in this etcd, what capabilities are available, and that's what he finds by doing the node discovery during the pod initialization time frame. You have the link there. I'm just putting the link there and there, thereby you will be able to go and read those application notes. Okay, so a first class, second class distinction, basically not all nodes are created equal. So some nodes have higher performance network interface cards, some nodes don't have. So how do you now know that? So what I did till now, right, I just touched upon all of that very briefly. The further files are pretty much going to take each one of them and slightly drill down and go and detail. So it may look like repetition, but it is not. Till now we saw four features, now we are going to spend each feature maybe 2-3 files. Okay, so this one is talking about how do you distinguish and differentiate and then identify them, right? So when I say node feature discovery, somebody should not think that, oh, I'm inserting some new NIC, something hot plug will it detect. No, this is just one time power on, you just go and execute that pod discovery task and it will and then notify, and then the labels will be kept, and then runtime it will be used, right? Detects hardware features that are available at node level. How does Kubernetes use this information for scheduling containerized VNFs for best match? And the core manager, what he does, again, basically the same thing, right? EPA and CPU pinning. Single node can run many parts. Some of these parts could be running CPU intensive workload, right? You are talking about characterizing your application, whether it is CPU intensive or whether it is network intensive. So that's what you do, and then you accordingly place, right? Policies are used by the CPU core manager. Low latency, high performance containers. How can the CPU manager help? It allocates excessive CPUs for demanding workload, because you may have C group, right? You may have C group, and now let's say one of this, you, and then there are commonalities, and you allocated all of them in one place. but then C groups limits the rationing of the resources, but suddenly somebody is very CPU intensive and is grabbing all the power, what do? You will want to place him out in somewhere else, right? Or you will throttle him. So how do you do that? That's the policies what CPU manager will do. What to do, whether you take it away, take him away, or ration, increase the ration for him, or what, right? Okay, let us look at the block diagram. Is the CPU manager, where the CPU manager sits? Is it a part of master, or if it's a master, is the part of minion? Is the question? Yeah, let's look at the. CPU core manager, okay. So the problem here is that that part has both master and minion. The first one has both master and minion. Okay. Where's the CPU master? Under all here, huh? So this is the default default. Okay. So I have to get back to my feeling it is part of the master, but then we are talking about so granularity, right? The communication has to happen, then it's a overhead. So I need to look at how it is done really. I don't remember right now. Correct. Once you ask, yeah, I had the same thinking, so I need to get back. Okay, let's keep going. I have what, 2 minutes, which means I need to use the time for question, I guess. I think I already gave time for question, so I'm going to take 2 minutes. So, okay, this is what the idea of putting this here again is, we went through all of that and now we are coming back to say that we have done a good job of going through all of that, whether it is true or not. Okay. So as we said, right, CNI, this is the default Kubernetes, and then this is what we are talking about adding, multi-CNI plugin, and you have this default one, the master type of one, default one, and then you have the kernel SRIV, and then you have DPD, kernel SRIV, and then you have DPDK SRIV. And then, so this is the default color, what you see, this color is what default was there, and these are all what we have added with the DPDK plugins. Okay, I think this is what we talked about, right, Flannel and Calico and all those things, the first one, and then the SRIV plugins with using the kernel and then the DPDK in the order of performance. There are two ways of doing the CNI. Let's say you have all the parts are going to use same interface, then you can use something called config file. But if you have parts within the same node, but each one has a different requirement for the interface, then you have to go by the objects. There are two different ways of doing it. So if you go into network builder, you'll be able to see application nodes, which talks about how it is done, a lot of screenshots. So if you want to know more information or pointers to those application nodes, you can send me an email, I can send it that to you, okay? This is the flowchart of how things are done. I was talking about object is one way, config file is another way. In the object way, how things are done, how do you create something called a custom resource definition and things like that. Again, it's a part of application note. Object is, if you have a requirement of having each pod having a different network, then you have to go for object. And then there's this white paper talks about how you create the object and how you use the kubectl and then how do you do those things are there. Okay, I have 30 seconds.
Maybe you can give it for questions, that 30 seconds. Any question?
The question was, how was the question? how the objects are managed? So I was giving the answer saying that if you are talking about all the interfaces having same characteristics, then it goes by the config file, but if each pod has different requirement for network, then you go by the objects, and then kubectl is used to create the objects and then CRDs, and the white paper talks about that, okay. We talked about the node labels for the capabilities, and this talks about the how you can, this is a test case of noisy neighbor and how using DPDK test PMD, how you can use all of these network configurations and then enhance the container towards VNF type of application, okay. And if you see here, this is the only thing that was there in the default Kubernetes, only one, right? Whereas these things are all because of your plugins, what DPDK is doing. And then the last one is, when you say CPUs availability, it also talks about categorizing as control plane, data plane, and infra plane. Infra plane and it's more like you can share these things. So as data plane, you can have multiple slots, and you can say this is one data plane list of CPUs. This is another data plane list of CPUs, and now you can use isol CPUs, and then you can pin your workload and all those things. Call for action, multi CNA plugin, SRIU CNA plugin, net node feature discovery, CPU core manager. So you know you have all the GitHubs. You can go and take it and then work on that on Sunday. Acknowledgements. I copied everything from all of these files. Okay, I'm done. Any other questions?
Yeah, thanks,
ask,
MJ.
Ask Sri Hari.
I have one question.
Okay.
Or SRIOV.
Yeah, some of the application notes have that. So send me a mail. I will send you the tables which has that.
I didn't see OVS DPDK into the plugin list. Is that also supported?
So the moment you have SRIOV, you use SRIOV, and then with the application what you run, you have OVS.
Okay.
That's all, right?
Any more questions?